Welcome you to the 21st meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from Siobhan McMahon. Agenda item one is for the committee to take evidence from the Scottish Government Bill team responsible for the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill. Can I welcome Barry Stalker, Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill team leader, and Kirsten Simonnet-Lefevre, solicitor at the Scottish Government. Can I invite Mr Stalker to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Government set out its vision for the private rented sector in its strategy published in 2013. This is for a private rented sector that provides good quality homes and high management standards, inspires consumer confidence and encourages growth through attracting increased investment. This bill will contribute to realising this vision by introducing a new private residential tenancy which will improve security of tenure for tenants and provide appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. This policy has been developed from the work of the Tenancy Review Group, which ministers established to examine the current tenancy regime. The group reported to ministers in May 2014 and recommended that the short-assured and assured tenancy be replaced by a new private tenancy that covers all future PRS lets. The ability for a landlord to end a tenancy on a specified date, commonly known as a no-fault ground, is not included in the bill. Instead, landlords will be able to recover possession of the property using new modernised grounds. These are to cover all the reasonable circumstances that a landlord would need. 12 of the 16 grounds are mandatory. Improved security for tenants will mean that they can no longer be evicted without a reason specified in legislation. This will enable tenants to assert their rights where this is necessary, such as with regard to property condition, without the concern of possible arbitrary eviction. This will also help tenants feel more settled in their home and in their communities. We know that currently it is tenants that are most likely to end their tenancy, and where a tenant does serve notice to quit, most tenants leave at that point without the need for the landlord to go to court. We expect this pattern to broadly continue. Under the new tenancy, should a tenant contest a notice to leave, then the landlord can apply to the first-tier tribunal to recover possession. The tribunal will provide an accessible, specialist form of redress for both tenants and landlords. As the new tenancy is effectively an open-ended tenancy, the bill also makes provision for rents. Tenants will be protected against excessive rent increases that take their rent to beyond the market rate. Adjudication will be provided by the Rent Service Scotland with a route of appeal to the first-tier tribunal. The bill also provides for rent predictability, where rent increases can only take place once in a 12-month period, with 3 months' notice. This will help tenants plan their finances for any future rent increases. And where rents in a local area have risen excessively, and this is having a detrimental effect on tenants and housing, local authorities will be able to apply to ministers to designate a rent pressure zone. Before making the decision, ministers will need to consult with both landlords and tenants. Any rent cap will apply to sitting tenants, be for a minimum of CPI plus 1%, and be for a period of up to 5 years. The Scottish Government has consulted extensively on this bill, including undertaking 2 public consultations since October 2014. This led to 2,500 and 7,500 responses respectively. We have listened to all stakeholders and sought to understand their perspective on what was being proposed. This has informed the policy development, and for example, the number of grounds for possession has increased from 8 to 16. We have also undertaken impact assessments, including on business, children's rights and well-being, and equalities. These found that improving security of tenure could particularly benefit some vulnerable groups who may have previously found it difficult to find secure long-term accommodation in the PRS. The bill has the potential to advance the realisation of children's rights and well-being, and while it is recognised that there may be some reduction in flexibility for landlords in managing their properties compared to the current system, this will not significantly affect the most important driver to get a return on investment. Landlords will still be able to charge market rents, to recover possession, for example, if tenants don't pay the rent or to sell their property, and lenders will still be able to recover possession in the event of mortgage default. Overall, ministers have sought to strike a fair balance in what is being proposed in the bill, and to ensure that the new tenancy will support a well-functioning sector, is fit for the modern PRS and works for both tenants and landlords.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stalker. Perhaps I could kick off just by asking what are the key differences between the current short assured tenancy framework and the proposed new tenancy?
Okay. The key differences between the current assured tenancy framework and the new tenancy, the first element is the new tenancy is clearer and simpler. So one of the issues that the review group found with the assured tenancy system is that it's cumbersome, complex, ambiguous, and it's quite difficult for many people to really understand. There's lots of pre-notice requirements. It's quite easy for a landlord who thinks they've got a short assured tenancy to in fact have an assured tenancy if they haven't served all the notices in the right order and so on. So one of the key considerations from the review group was to have the new tenancy that was simpler and clearer to use so that everybody understood the rights and obligations. So I think that's the first key difference. The second one, as I outlined in my opening statement, is that this rebalances the relationship between tenants and landlords. So under the assured tenancy system, landlords who use a short assured tenancy are able to, if they choose, end the tenancy at the end date on the no-fault ground. And this is not something which has been included in the new tenancy. In effect, landlords will need a reason, and all reasonable grounds will be, all reasonable circumstances have been included in the grounds. So that's the second difference. And I think finally, the assured tenancy system is developed in a different age, in the late 1980s. And actually, there's a lot of evidence to suggest that the short assured tenancy wasn't really intended to be used that commonly, but in practice it has become the most common tenancy to use. What this new tenancy provides is a tenancy which works for the sector that PRS has become today. It's a modern tenancy for the private rented sector, which has grown substantially over the recent years and includes a large number of tenants who are looking to settle in the longer term, as well as those that continue to look for the flexibility that the PRS has always provided for.
You talked about rebalancing the relationship between tenants and landlords. Is it the government's view then that the current short assured tenancy arrangements and framework disadvantages the tenant?
The government's view is that it can, and one of the sort of key benefits that we're looking to achieve from the new tenancy is to help tenants better assert their rights without the potential concern around receiving eviction for no specified reason. There's many good landlords in the PRS, and the PRS serves a really important and plays a really important part in delivering housing supply across Scotland. But there are still, and we know there's still, issues around quality in the sector, and particularly around property condition. And having this new tenancy should help tenants feel more at home and more settled in the communities, and also help them, where it's necessary, be able to speak to the landlord and ask them to comply with their obligations, and if necessary, then use the rights that they have, for example, to go to the Housing Tribunal.
Okay. Can I ask you about consultation? You mentioned the high level of responses, up to 7,500, that there had been to the consultation process, and you talked about the impact assessments that have been carried out. Are you satisfied that the consultation process has been sufficiently rigorous and robust to gather all of the views of the people who are going to be affected by this legislation? And can you tell us what steps you took to take the temperature of the sector and of tenants more widely?
The short answer to your question is yes. As an official, I am satisfied. We undertook two public consultations. The first consultation, we also commissioned focus groups to basically reach out to tenants and landlords who may not necessarily always look to participate in consultations. So we did that. We undertook two public consultations. As officials, we've always been available to engage with stakeholders, whether it be at public events or be open to discuss with them any of the issues or concerns that they may have with what we're proposing, or indeed the opportunities that they see for the new tenancy. So we've always done that as well. And I think that if you look at the kind of trajectory of where we've gone, there has been changes that we've made to what we eventually put in the bill. So I mentioned earlier about the number of grounds increasing. So clearly, the balance is that landlords need to feel confident that the grounds cover all reasonable circumstances. And we went from 8 to 16. For example, we included a ground which landlords have long been calling for on abandonment. So we've listened to landlords. We've also listened to the tenants' representatives groups as well. So I think that we have done all we can and will continue to listen to what stakeholders think about the proposals that we've put in the bill.
Yeah, that's very helpful. Thank you. Can you explain the bill's provisions regarding the statutory terms of the tenancy as set out in Part 2 of the bill and the tenancy information requirements similar to the current tenant information pack provisions as set out in Part 3 of the bill, and perhaps tell us what benefits these provisions might provide to both tenants and landlords?
Okay, I'll start, and I might ask my colleague from the Scottish Government Legal Directorate to contribute as well. I suppose in terms of the tenancy terms, what this is a new tenancy. So it's not building on the 80 Act, it's not building on the assured tenancy, it's a new tenancy. It's a new statutory tenancy, and it's an open-ended tenancy. And so what Part 2 does is that it basically sets out the statutory terms of this new tenancy. These are the key terms that that will apply to all of the tenancies under the new regime. What Part 3 does is that it looks at the information that needs to be required. So as you correctly say, currently the landlords are required to provide information. It's a mandatory requirement to tenants through the Tenants Information Pack. And we are looking to continue the requirement for landlords to provide key information to tenants through the new tenancy system, because what we want to achieve is we want the new tenancy to be clear for everyone to understand what it means for them and also what their rights and responsibilities are. Kirsten, is there anything in particular you want to pick up on there?
In guidance, we will be issuing a model tenancy agreement, and that will contain the statutory terms, which are in Schedule 2, and also discretionary terms that may be used by landlords. Now, where, for example, landlords and tenants agree more generous rights of access notice rather than 40 hours in mail for 3 days' notice, then there might be a possibility for the statutory terms to be overridden. So there will be an ability in the regulations for landlords and tenants to agree slightly more generous terms to override the statutory terms once we make the regulations. And it also allows further statutory terms to be added to the list should that be needed in the future. And the information which landlords have to give to tenants would include the written terms of the tenancy and any other information that needs to be passed over in relation to condition of the property, etc. And we're going to bring forward regulations which will set all that out quite clearly, together with the method by which the information may be given, perhaps on paper or electronically or by text. There may be a number of ways in which landlords and tenants are able to communicate with each other with this new simplified tenancy arrangement.
Can I just ask for clarification? The model tenancy agreement, that will be contained in the regulations?
No, it won't be as such. It will give the statutory terms, and there will be guidance which will give other discretionary terms, and there will be a framework which people will be able to use.
Do you have any indication at this stage of what the timescales will be on the publication of those?
On the model tenancy agreement, and that is something, as Kirsten said, is it would need to develop through secondary legislation. We look to hit the ground running quickly on that, and we'd obviously need to have it completed in time for the new tenancy commencing, which we are looking to do by late 2017.
Okay, thank you. Mike, you have some questions?
The bill proposes an initial tenancy period of 6 months. Can you explain a wee bit about why that six-month period was chosen? I mean, for instance, was consideration given to a longer period for that initial tenancy?
The concept behind the initial tenancy period comes from the initially comes from the review group. So this is one of the things they considered. And in summary, because a short-term tenancy tends to work in a six-monthly block, that's the kind of building blocks of how things work at the moment, I think that there was a kind of view that it would be good to try and have something which would carry that over to help the sector kind of transfer from the current tenancy to the new one. It's intended to provide tenants and landlords with assurance. So what the initial period will do is, for a tenant, it will limit the grounds that a landlord would be able to seek repossession on. So they wouldn't be able to seek repossession on most of the grounds. But from a landlord's perspective, it would mean that the tenant would be tied into staying into that property and paying rent for that specified period of time. So if you're a landlord and you're going to put your property on them into the PRS, then you know there'll be transaction costs and so on involved in doing that. You probably want to have a tenant in there in the longer term, but certainly for the short term, that's something which felt landlords would find helpful. But equally, from a tenant's point of view, there needs to be balance. And there's a number of grounds, such as the landlord intending to sell, and where they wouldn't be able to do that under the initial tenancy period. So that would provide tenants with the reassurance that they'd also have a degree of stability over that period. The trick here is we've tried to do stability and flexibility, and we recognise that the PRS does both. And where a tenant would like a shorter period, and the landlord is content with that, then that initial period can be for less than 6 months. But for a landlord to offer, we've set out in the legislation that it has to be for a minimum period of 6 months.
Okay, that seems to make sense. And just moving on to the approach the bill takes towards notices to end a tenancy, there's a different notice period for tenants, a shorter one for tenants than there is for landlords. Could you perhaps explain the reasoning behind that?
Okay, so you're right. So in terms of the notice periods, for a tenant, they would be required to give 4 weeks notice if they stay for less than 6 months, so up until that point, 4 weeks, and then 8 weeks from beyond that. And for a landlord, it would be for 4 weeks if it's before the 6 months period, and then after that it would be for 84 days, so basically 12 weeks. I suppose that the easiest is that when a landlord is recovering possession, then it's not their home, but it's a property, and they'll probably look to re-let it out again. So we felt that the time frame that we would set out would be sufficient for that. But when a tenant's looking to leave, then obviously it's their home they'll be leaving. So we thought that they should have a longer period, because a tenant would need to be, for example, looking for alternative accommodation. So again, it comes down to balance. But the reason, in summary, why landlords have a shorter notice period from a tenant is because we felt that landlords would be able to relet their property on the market, whereas tenants would need a bit more time to look for alternative accommodation.
Thank you. And there's a provision that prevents a tenant from ending a tenancy during the initial period unless it's with prior written agreement with the landlord. This seems to contravene, or potentially contravene, the tenant's common law right to rescind the tenancy for breach of contract. Is there a difficult arch?
This ensures that the tenant's tied in for the minimum period of 6 months. The reason why there's a right of rescission for common law tenancies is that tenants very often don't have many other remedies other than to end the tenancy when the landlord, say for example, doesn't repair a broken boiler. Whereas tenants who are in this sort of statutory tenancy arrangement, whether it's the current assured or the new private residential, have a large number of remedies and other pieces of legislation which ensures that landlords meet repairing standards, etc. So we felt that in order to give security to landlords, the tenants should be able to tie themselves in for that period and did not require the right of rescission because of all the other remedies available.
Right, OK, I'm not just quite sure that I'm 100% with you. So the tenant will still retain this common law right to rescind the agreement in the event of a breach by the landlord?
No, the tenant won't have the common law right simply to end the tenancy, but the tenant will have other rights to ensure that the landlord will comply with all the other requirements of the tenancy and other legislation.
So if I can chip in as well. So basically, again, it comes down to trying, looking to strike a balance here. By increasing security of tenant for tenants, that it helps enable tenants to assert their rights. So if you take the example of condition, where a landlord has not met their obligations, a tenant should be able to speak to the landlord about that, and then if they don't do anything about it, they've got a course of redress to the tribunal. So in that situation, that's what I think Kirsten is referring to. Tenants, where a landlord's not meeting their obligations, do have means of redress to be able to ensure that the landlord does. And I think what Kirsten's saying is that in other areas they may not have the same range of redress available, and therefore probably the only form of action they've got is to end the agreement. But that's not what we see as the case in the new tenancy.
Okay, thank you. And just moving on to my final.
Could I just ask a question then?
Are you confident that the tenant isn't losing out in any way by this change?
What we have done is sought to strike a balance. So I mentioned earlier about rebalancing the relationship between tenants and landlords. What that's done is it's maintaining landlords' confidence in letting out their property, but improving tenants' security and also improving their position to be able to assert their rights, as well as how they feel about their home and how settled they can feel where they stay. Okay.
Thank you. Forgive me for being a bit pedantic. I'm just going to seek a wee bit further clarification, and perhaps it will assist us if, you mentioned the situation of a tenant with a boiler broken down. So there's no heating. It's the middle of the winter. The landlord is unable to or refuses to repair the boiler, and the tenant at that point can't end the tenancy but has to go to the tribunal. Now, given that set of circumstances I've described, are you confident that the tribunal would perhaps be able to take effective action before the tenant froze to death? Sorry to put it in those terms, but I'm just trying to get a proper understanding of this.
Okay. What I will say is that when you're setting out, obviously, legislation like this, you tend to set it in the generality. That's obviously a very specific and in the extreme scenario, which nobody would want. In terms of what we've set out, on balance, it was felt that this would provide tenants with the ability to assert their rights and to go to the tribunal, which will be an effective place for them to go. And indeed, the tribunal is something which not just tenants but landlords have long called for and been supportive of as a form of redress, which is more accessible and also provides basically specialist redress on housing in a way that was less so in a more general sense when under the current system where they need to go to court.
Thank you. And if I maybe just move on.
Oh, finished, Michael.
But I have one more question, convener, I think, to ask, but I'm very happy for.
On this subject, have you looked at the evidence of how tenants use the common law right at the moment, and to what extent they use the refer cases to the tribunal? Because there could be an argument it's much easier for tenants to use the common law rights than it is to access a tribunal, in which case this would be a disadvantage to tenants. Could you perhaps tell us what evidence you've looked at in this area?
Okay. Well, I mean, in terms of the tribunals, you know, as you probably are aware, the tribunals are changing. So at the moment, issues to do with reconditioning the PRS, to do with the appearing standard, tenants would go to the private rented housing panel, which is a tribunal, which will merge into the first two tribunal that we refer to in the accompanying documents. So at the moment, the PRHP receives around about 200 to 300 applications a year, which is mainly for appearing standard, but can also be, in some cases, with regards to rent. That is perhaps not as high a number of applications as you might expect when you look at the evidence around some of the parts of the PRS where there are issues with condition. So what we are looking to achieve from the new tenancy and by improving tenant security of tenure is to help tenants use the redress which is available to them at the moment, so that, you know, because of the staying summit and they're regarding it as their home, they might well want to improve where they are and not have to move. They might want, you know, to actually have where they stay and consider as a home, you know, meet the requirements that it should do on, and maybe even beyond. So the evidence at the moment is that there could well be more cases that will go to the tribunal based on the new tenancy that we've set out, and that's something which we've reflected in the accompanying documents, including the financial memorandum.
Okay, well, we can explore that with other witnesses, I think.
Michael.
Thank you, convener. I'm just moving on to another area.
One of the significant proposals of the bill is to remove the no-fault ground for repossession. In terms of the balance of, you know, to be struck between providing tenants with greater security of tenure and the kind of concerns we've heard from landlords about this hindering investment in the private rented sector, how did you reconcile those two, you know, concerns?
Well, I mean, it comes down to balance. I mean, ministers set the overall objective, which is to improve security of tenure for tenants, balanced with appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders, and investors. And that's what's kind of driven the subsequent development of the policy on the new tenancy. The balance that we've struck is that landlords need to feel confident that they'll be able to manage their properties effectively, and that's why the grounds are important. And we've said that the legislation must set out provide grounds for all the reasonable circumstances that landlords would need to recover possession of their property. And then I've talked previously about benefits to tenants around not having a no-fault ground in the new tenancy system. Ultimately, and I think I mentioned this at the end of my opening statement, what's most important to landlords is that they're able to get a return on their investment. And in the grounds, for example, that we've proposed, they'll still be able to do that. They'll be able to charge market rents for their properties. They'll be able to sell the property to realise its capital value if that's something which they want to do. They'll be able to manage their properties effectively because we've provided for grounds that will do that. So there's, I think from the government's perspective, there's nothing that we see in this bill that would fundamentally affect landlords' investment in the sector. But that said, we have listened carefully to landlords. And we know that there is a strength of feeling out there that landlords don't want to have the no-fault grounds not included in the bill, and they have made that case strongly to us. But on balance, ministers' position is that that's the right balance to strike. And what's important is that landlords will still be able to, through what we set out in the new tenancy, effectively manage their properties, and in particular, that's why the grounds are important to get right.
Yeah, being removed and replaced with a series of other criteria. In terms of the 7,500 responses that you received, have you done an evaluation of how the responses divide between those that are in favour and those that are against that provision?
In terms of, well, the first consultation asked basically the question on the broad policy intention around the no-fault ground. And 81% of those who responded were in favour of it, but not landlords and investors who were predominantly opposed to the removal of it. So in terms of the consultation, it depends on which way you look at it, but in simple terms, landlords and letting agents and investors tended to not favour the removal of it, whereas tenants' representative bodies and tenants' groups did favour the removal of it. I think from Minister's point of view, what's important is that balance I talked about, and also fundamentally, you know, considering the question, will this fundamentally alter the sector and what landlords will be able to get from the sector, which ultimately is to be able to manage their properties effectively and get a return on their investment.
I was just wanting to understand what the balance of opinion was in the consultation, and you've said that 81% of responses were in favour of the no-fault grounds being removed. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you. Mike, have you got any final questions?
It was just to explore this slightly more, and I absolutely accept that your suggestion that the primary motivation perhaps of any landlord is, you know, a return on their investment, but I just wonder if what the situation the landlord would be left in trying to remove an antisocial tenant. So it may well be the antisocial tenant continues to pay his rent, so the landlord's making good on his investment in that sense, but you know, there's an antisocial tenant, and as a good neighbour, responsible landlord, he wishes to try and take action. Is he impeded from doing so in terms of the proposals regarding the no-fault ground being removed?
In the proposals that were set in the bill, landlords will not be impeded in being able to deal with antisocial behaviour. The challenge of antisocial behaviour is to be honest, it's not an easy thing for anyone to deal with. And you know, I mean, on the one hand, you could have a situation where, you know, there is genuine antisocial behaviour. It could be subjective. It depends on one person's view might be antisocial, another person might be just a different lifestyle. And to illustrate that, if you have an elderly couple living next door to a young family, you know, you could have somebody likes living peace and quiet next door to somebody who makes quite a lot of noise. So it's never really an easy thing to kind of, I think, for a landlord to kind of deal with. And what's important though is that when looking at the potential for someone to be evicted from their home, there should be fair and due process. And that's what we set out in the bill. So if there's an issue with antisocial behaviour, landlords will still be able to effectively deal with that. First of all, by engaging with the tenant and looking to resolve the problems with them or possibly the neighbours. Ultimately, if it comes to it, they've got a ground that they're able to use in the tenancy agreement. To evict a tenant if that's something which is necessary.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener.
James.
Good morning. I'd just like to ask you a couple of questions around the eviction grounds. I see that there are a number of eviction grounds, and that some of them have received strong support, some of them seem to have received mixed support. Could you tell me, can you briefly outline the proposed process for the landlord to end the tenancy and the role of the tribunal in this regard?
Okay. So if a landlord wants to end a tenancy, so we've simplified it and made it clearer. So there's one notice to leave. So if a landlord wants to end a tenancy, they will issue a notice to leave to the tenant, and they will need to do that within the correct sort of time period. They'll need to cite the ground which they're asking the tenant to leave on. The tenant then can either leave, and we've provided for that in the grounds. If a tenant leaves of their own accord, then that will bring the tenancy to an end. But if a tenant chooses to stay and contest the notice to leave, then they are also able to do that. At that point, a landlord will need to send a notice to leave to the tribunal. They will also need to, under Section 11 of the 2003 Homelessness Act, inform the local authority that they are seeking eviction as well. So we've joined that up with that legislation. When the tribunal received the notice to leave, the landlord will have that. They will put the evidence in, and it's for the tribunal to determine. Now, 12 of the 16 grounds in the legislation are mandatory, which means that if the tribunal determines that the ground has been met, then they must order they must order repossession to the landlord. And then the other four, it's either discretionary or discretionary and mandatory. Now, we know that in most cases tenants will leave, and we know that in most cases currently where a landlord asks the tenant to leave, then the tenant does that. But we accept that there will be cases where tenants quite rightly, because that is their right, will be able to contest the notice to leave, and that's where the role of the tribunal will come in.
Can I ask, I believe that all the grounds used to be mandatory, now under the provision of this, the four of them, as you say, are going to be discretionary. Can I ask why some are discretionary?
Well, when all the grounds were mandatory, there was 8, and now there's 16. We're looking to strike a balance. We've listened to stakeholders. I mean, you know, the balance is such that we need to be fair to tenants and to landlords. Landlords need to feel confident that they'll be able to recover possession of their property. We also need to be fair to tenants, that the ground would be reasonable for them to leave their home. So that's why there are some which are not all mandatory. And I think, again, it comes down to seeking appropriate balance.
Okay, can I just go on to another point then? Homeless Action Scotland and Shelter Scotland have suggested that the grounds covering situations where the property is required for another purpose by the landlord do not contain definitions sufficiently tight enough to protect against the potential for abuse by the landlord. How would the Scottish Government respond to such concerns?
Okay, well, I mean, what we're doing in the bill is we're setting out the legislation. Clearly, there's work to be done once, if Parliament passes the bill. There's work to be done beyond that through secondary legislation and all the other work as well. So in effect, what we've got on the face of the bill is the high-level sort of principles around that. You know, we also intend to issue guidance to landlords so that they'll be clear of what evidence will be required. Clearly, the tribunal will have a view on what the grounds mean and the evidence that they'll be looking for to ensure that the ground is indeed met. And we've put in safeguards as well, so that if a tenant believes that a landlord has sought eviction but hasn't actually been genuine, then tenants will be able to go to the tribunal to seek compensation if the tribunal finds in their favour. Again, it's about balance. Landlords need to feel confident. In the main, most landlords will be absolutely genuine. They need to feel confident that they'll be able to recover possession of the property, which is why they put it up for rent and then make that contribution to housing supply. But on the other hand, you know, tenants need to be confident that when a landlord says that they're seeking repossession on a specified ground, that is indeed genuine.
And have you asked? I take it Homeless Action Scotland and Shelter Scotland will be aware of what you've just said to me, and or have you still got some persuading to do with it?
Well, we speak to all stakeholders, including Homeless Action Scotland and Shelter on a regular basis. So I think they may well be aware of what I've said to you.
Okay, right, thank you.
David, did you want to come in at this point?
Thank you, Convener. Can I touch on a question that Shelter have raised with me about rent arrears? And basically, their concern is that the ground 11 on rent arrears is disproportionate and unfair to tenants. Perhaps Mr. Stalker or his colleague could answer a very specific point. I've looked at ground 11 and it talks about rent arrears over a 3-month period and not 3 months rent arrears. Now, it may seem a pedantic point, but let me give you, for example, someone's got a new job, they're waiting for a salary to come in, they're 1 month behind and they're unable to catch up in that 3-month period. Technically, you're in arrears over a 3-month period, which is the ground for eviction. So the point I'm making is, and the point Shelter makes, are we right in raising concerns that for a 1 month arrears over a 3-month period, you could be evicted? That seems to me and seems to Shelter to be unfair and disproportionate. And if that is correct, Mr. Stalker, could you look at amending legislation so that ground is changed?
Okay, thanks. I mean, you set out how the ground works. Again, it comes down to a balance. Ministers have sought to strike the right balance, and I mentioned previously why that's important to do so. Clearly, there's still some debate around whether the 1 month is sufficient for the mandatory term to kick in. It's probably a question for the minister, and one that she may be happy to answer. But from a policy point of view, what we try to do is have.
Excuse me. I know you can't give a commitment on behalf of the minister, but in theory, could you be looking at replacing 3 months with, say, 6 months?
Well, in theory, what we'll do is we'll respond to the stage one report, which the committee will provide.
Just to echo that point, I think it's about, obviously we have to balance the needs of tenants, and obviously we look at the needs of owners as well. I fully understand that. It certainly seems to me that shelter have a point here, and that the scenario where you are 1 month in arrears over a 3 month period is very, very unfair to tenants. And I would assume as well that owners don't particularly want that, because voids are not a good thing in your cash flow either. So, I mean, owners would want to make sure that there's security as well. I do think this, the way it's phrased, is unfair. And I know you can't, as an official, make commitments today, but could you ask the minister to perhaps go homeward and think again on this particular line? Because I do think it's unfair, and I think tenants across Scotland will think it's grossly unfair. So, and the rest of the bill seems to me to be sensible in lots of ways. I don't think this ground is sensible, so please look at this and try and get this changed on behalf of tenants.
If you've got a brief comment on that, that would be...
I'll be happy to relay to the Minister your general support for the bill, but also the points that you've made.
Thank you. We're going to move on now. Adam, you have some questions.
Yes. on questions on additional grounds relating to a number of factors like student lets and holiday lets, some suggestions have been made by respondents to the consultation for additional eviction grounds. Weren't taken forward by the Scottish Government. In particular, there's no general eviction ground allowing landlords to recover properties let to students at the end of the academic year, or more generally, properties required for the purposes of a subsequent holiday let. Can you explain the Government's reasoning for not adopting these suggestions?
Okay, well, the overall aim set by ministers was to improve security for tenants, balance with safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. So that's guided the policy development in this area. We also, as I mentioned earlier, want to have a system which is clear, simple to understand. And ministers took the position that they want all tenants that transfer from the old current assured system across into this new system to be treated in the same way, have the same rights under the new tenancy. When you have one tenancy which is broad, it broadly covers a diverse sector, then there will be an element of strains around the margins on that. And I think what you've outlined there is an example of that. We recognise that for the student market, that landlords will need to adapt their practice to reflect the changes of the new tenancy, but it shouldn't be, we think, insurmountable. So, for example, if you look at what we've provided in the legislation, the minimum time that a tenant can provide in terms of notice to leave is 8 weeks, but it could be more. So if a landlord is looking to manage their property and is looking at, a tenant who's a student, they could ask them, have you got an idea when you might be looking to move out? And that's obviously up to the tenant to decide, but there's nothing to stop a landlord asking that question. And if the tenant leaves it to the last possible moment, they've still got 8 weeks in which they'll know for certain that the tenant's looking to leave the property. So that does still provide a window for a landlord to be able to look to relet the property. But we do accept that this will have some impact on the holiday lets and on the student market. And we think that fundamentally the sector will be able to adapt to this.
Yeah, there was some question with regards to the holiday let that under the 1988 Act, a landlord might be able to operate a business model which involves mainly longer-term lets, but with some short-term holiday lets over the summer. Say, for example, in Edinburgh with the festival on the go. Is this, will that still be possible using the new legislation? Well,
what the 88 Act does is there's grounds in there which I think basically says that if a landlord lets a property out to a tenant, they've previously let the property out as a holiday let, they inform the tenant that it has been let out as a holiday let and they intend to do so again. I think that would allow them to be able to use the ground to recover possession. Alternatively, if they're on a short-term tenancy, they can just set a date and then recover possession in that way. Under the new tenancy, it's about improving security for tenants, and key to this has been the removal of the no-fault ground. That's been something which has been very central in the Minister's position on this. So with that in mind, then it would be quite difficult to then have a ground which in effect looks like a no-fault ground to be able to bring a tenancy to an end for the purposes then of it being a holiday let or for it being the end of term for a student. Overall, the government's position is that what we set out, there may be some adaptation, but it will still be able to work in those markets.
Okay, thanks. Can I now raise some issues associated with the first tier tribunal? Can you update the committee when the tribunal will be operational and how it might work in practice? In particular, the timescales that eviction cases might take, the cost of using the tribunal, and the potential for legal aid to be available for tenants.
Okay. On timescale, the tribunal, the new tribunal system, is currently being created, and the legislation that is derived from the 2014 Tribunals Act has been implemented. The new tribunal will start, first of all, with a housing and property chamber, and this will start in late 2016. And then there'll be a stage process where more of the existing tribunals will move into it, and it'll develop and build. It'll build from there. On costs, that's not a matter for this bill, but what I can say is that ministers have not reached a position on whether or not to charge a fee for anyone going to the tribunal. In terms of the PRS element of it, which is from the 2014 Housing Act, which will be moving into the new first year tribunal, where the current tenancy arrangements under short-term tenancy will merge in. I think landlords currently charge £70 to go to court. Now that may or may not be something which carries on in terms of a fee for the new tribunal. That's a decision which hasn't been met. But as it stands at the moment, if there's no fee, then that would represent a saving to landlords that need to go to the tribunal. And in terms of legal aid, tribunal procedures are designed to be accessible and understandable and do not generally require legal representation. This will also be a case in the new PRS tribunal, as I understand it. We recognise that the cases will be handled by the tribunal, including those involving repossession. They can be serious in nature. We're considering the requirements of support for parties bringing a case to the tribunal. And this will be done through the operational detail of delivering the tribunal. This could be through funding support for legal representation and or some form of lay representation. Funding support for legal representation in other tribunal jurisdictions is generally provided through assistance by way of representation or ABWAR, which is administered by the Scottish Legal Aid Board. If selected, this would be set in place by secondary legislation, which would be scrutinised by Parliament. That's the position on legal aid as I understand it.
Okay, well, these are matters we can follow up with the Minister. Now, Shelter Scotland has suggested the tribunal should have discretion to adjourn tribunal proceedings, for example, to monitor payments relating to rent arrears or to monitor a tenant's behaviour in antisocial behaviour cases. What is the government's view on this?
I don't think it's something we've got in the bill
at present. It's not something we have in the bill at the moment. partly because that may come out in the rules of the tribunal itself. They'll have the ability to desist or adjourn in all types of cases if we're not sure what's going to be in their regulations as to how they will have procedures. Perhaps we may be looking to make a change to put something in at stage two on that. But we were waiting to see what their regulations were with regard to the procedure so that we didn't duplicate provisions about procedure in various different pieces of legislation.
Thank you. I can follow up on that too.
Okay. That's very helpful. Thank you. Just following on from the line of questioning on the first tier tribunal, can I ask about recourse to the tribunal in the cases of wrongful termination? The bill at sections 47 to 49 proposes that a tenant will have recourse to the first tier tribunal if they believe their tenancy has been wrongfully terminated. Therefore, can you explain the objectives behind these provisions in the bill and how you think they will work in practice?
Okay, I mean, the intention here is going back to what we said earlier around making sure that landlords are indeed genuine. So one of the sort of safeguards we've put in place is that where a landlord, and we don't envisage many landlords would do this, but where a landlord has been disingenuous, that a tenant would be able to seek compensation. So, for example, on the first ground, landlord intends to sell. If a landlord issues a notice to quit, intends to sell, the tenant is evicted on that basis, and then 3 weeks later, the tenant discovers that the place they were living in is rented to someone else, then that would seem like an example of where they should have some recourse. What we want to do is something which is effective and has teeth. One of the most effective ways of doing that, we think, is by giving tenants ability where they feel that they've not been treated genuinely, the ability to basically seek compensation from the landlord. Again, it comes down to balance, but that's the basic policy intention behind those provisions.
Just on this point of ensuring that these provisions are, to use your words, effective and have teeth, can I ask you about evidence that we've received and written evidence from Homeless Action Scotland, who have suggested that very few tenants will bring a case against a landlord to the tribunal? Did the Scottish Government consider enabling and empowering third parties such as local authorities, law centres or advice agencies to have the ability to bring cases against landlords in order to raise actions at the tribunal on behalf of tenants?
I mean, that's of course Homeless Action Scotland's view. I mean, our reckoning is that there might well be very few, in the sense that there might not be a need for very many to go to tribunal, but tenants should be able to go to tribunal. If they need help and assistance, then there's different ways that could be provided. For example, there's nothing to stop them taking a case to tribunal with assistance from one of the vice agencies out there. But I don't think that something we've included in the bill, specifically the ability for a third party to go to the tribunal.
Would that provision not fulfil your aspiration to ensure that the provisions are effective and have teeth?
Well, I think that what's important that they are effective and have teeth. So we've given tenants that ability, and you know they'd also be able to seek assistance if that's what they needed.
I think that's the one for the minister when she appears before the committee. I'm going to move on and ask Alec Johnson to ask some questions.
Thank you very much. I wanted to look at the process for increasing rent and challenging rent increases. First of all, what is the policy objective behind the rent increase provisions in the bill?
So the policy objective really on rent is this. It's an open-ended tenancy, therefore we need to consider how to deal with rents, because what we don't want is to increase security for tenants, but then for that to potentially be subverted by rent hikes. So the ability for a tenant to seek adjudication on an unreasonable rent increase, which takes their rent beyond the market rate, is in for that reason. We've also included predictability as well So rents can only be increased once in a 12-month period with 3 months' notice, and that is to help tenants plan for any, basically plan the finances for any future rent increase. But fundamentally, what we're seeing is that rents and the PRS are market-led, and I think that both those provisions on rents show that.
How do you assess what the market rate is? Because I know that some of the people I've spoken to are suggesting that the market rates are going up, but that can be perhaps based on advertised due lets, for example, whereas the suggestion is that the rates in some areas have been relatively flat or perhaps even declining. So what do we decide, or how do we decide what market rates are?
Well, and I think from a tenant's point of view, it would be, does this rent increase seem unreasonable? So you could go to an extreme example of, 20%, that seems quite a lot, and they might well be able to kind of just do a bit of basic looking around at what others might be paying. In terms of the determining the market rent, and that would be a matter for the Rent Service Scotland, who've got a lot of experience in this area currently, and they'd look to build on that to provide adjudication, and that would be a combination of the work that they do based on the data that they hold and also the inspections that they make to look at properties and determining what their market rent would be.
I'm slightly concerned about the provisions that are included for the increase in a rent. Now, I know that for personal experience, I've rented the same flat in Edinburgh for 10 years and the rent's never gone up. Is it going to be the case that after this bill becomes law, that annually I'll have to pay, the taxpayer will have to pay CPI plus 1% extra? So is it an agenda for increasing rents where increases haven't been happening?
That's not the policy position. You're right, in the current practice, landlords tend to increase the rent at the end of a tenancy, basically the start of a new tenancy on the short tenancy system. What's in the bill will not require landlords to increase their rents once a year. It just means that where a landlord chooses to increase their rent, for whatever reason, they can only do that once every 12 months. And given that landlords currently, in many circumstances, don't increase rents that much for sitting tenants, then that was perhaps set fairly comfortably with that practice.
So where a tenant wants to challenge the rent, how easy is that going to be for them to do?
If a tenant wants to challenge the rent, then they'll be able to make an application to the Rent Service Scotland. And the policy intention there is that it should be easy for a tenant to do, and where there is a case to answer, the Rent Service will be able to make that determination.
Where a tenant is in that position where they're deciding whether they will proceed with a challenge to their rent increase or not, one of the pieces of information that would be vital to them is to know what typical rents are in their area. So how will they get that information? Will the government survey it and make it available, or will they be reliant on other organisations to tell them what the rent is in the area they're in?
I think a tenant will be able to look at a range of sources. I mean, you're right, the government does provide statistics on rent levels, so that would give anybody an indication of what's happening in terms of rents in general terms across Scotland. For individual tenants' rents, then they'll be able to look at perhaps what their friends are being charged for similar properties. They'll be able to go online. The PRS tends to be mainly, but not all, sort of younger folk who will be well versed at being able to kind of go online, look at for example, the different letting portals say rents are advertised are at. So I think there'll be a range of different sources that the tenants will be able to look at when thinking about whether or not the rent increase that they've received seems unreasonable, and ultimately it's for the Rent Service Scotland to determine whether it's unreasonable, which is based on whether or not it takes their rent beyond the market rate. So suppose the tenant's first protocol is, does this seem unreasonable?
In section 29 of the bill, that the rent officers and the tribunal have to publish information collectively to the public to say what rents are taken into account in doing adjudications and determinations and what amount of rent they made under the determinations under applications from individuals. So they will be publishing statistics that will be available to people. I'm not sure exactly how that will take place. I expect it will be on a website, and tenants who think they've received a rent notice that seems rather high can perhaps go into that in the first instance and see what the prices are generally in their area for similar types of property.
Are we in danger of being in a position where there is no a definitive or an authoritative voice on what rents or typical rents are in an area, and that may become an area for dispute in a case?
Ultimately, the authoritative voice will be the rent service, because they're the ones that will be determining whether or not a rent increase is unreasonable, taking the rent beyond the market rate. So that's kind of the end point, as Kirsten said, and that information, you know, will only grow as the work that they do increases.
Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Stalker, your statement in response to Mr. Johnson that is not the policy position was spoken like a true civil servant. I'm going to ask David Stewart to ask the final questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Can I raise the next issue about rent pressure zones? And I think at one level, I think members of the committee can understand the need for such a proposal. For example, in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, if you look at the period 2010 to 2014, for a two-bedroom house, rents went up by 40%, which is obviously a phenomenal figure. Although, in fairness, I would say because of the reduction in oil prices, that there has been a falling away in Aberdeen on that in more recent terms. So just to check that I understand this correctly, if a local authority feels that there's a demand, for example, in Aberdeen for this rent pressure zone, they apply to Scottish Government, and by an affirmation procedure, you could designate a zone. Could you confirm what the minimum size of the zone, for example, could it be an estate, could it be a village, could it be a town, could it be a city, or does it have to be the whole local authority area? The other issue is, why does it just apply to sitting tenants? If we're looking at a private rental sector in the long term, where a quarter now of tenants have children, who see the sector as being their long-term aspiration to stay in the private rental sector, why are we not looking at the zone applying to everyone, not just sitting tenants, people who aspire to be tenants who are in another form of tenure?
Okay, thanks. On your first question about the size of the zone, there's nothing in the legislation that determines the size of the zone, other than it's for local authority to make the application. The local authority will be able to set out the zone which they think is appropriate for the rent pressure zone to apply to. So that would be a matter for a local authority. On sitting tenants, I mean, again, this is another area where I think ministers have sought to strike the right balance. The fundamental sort of problem is in areas where rents have been increasing quite sharply, as you pointed out. The forefront of that will be the sitting tenants, because they're the ones that are getting the rent increases as rents are rising. So that's why the policy is to cap rents for sitting tenants in those circumstances. At the same time, the Scottish Government is committed to increasing overall housing supply, and recognise that that needs to be done both through public funding, but also through funding we're able to leverage in from private sources as well. And so we need to be able to attract that additional investment to build more houses. And that's why we've sought to strike the balance, so that investors will be able to understand what we're doing and why we're doing it, but we'll also still be able to make investment commitments so we can build more housing supply. Because fundamentally, the more houses that can be built, then ultimately that will help overall in circumstances where rents have been rising quite sharply. Basically, increasing supply is the longer-term solution to the problem. But the more immediate problem, of course, is where the rents which are rising sharply are having a detrimental impact on tenants and on housing. Then what the policy is, that this provides a discretionary measure that local authorities could apply to basically help mitigate that.
I mean, I do understand that. I think you probably picked up from the tone of my question. I thought it was quite a sensible provision. However, I do think it's a little bit confused. I think it would be much simpler if once the local authority applied for the zone, it applies to everyone, either existing tenants or potential tenants. For example, if you're in Aberdeen and you have two-bedroom properties, one of them is sitting tenant, the other isn't, then the rent increase would be CPI plus one for sitting tenants and anything you want for new tenants. That doesn't seem very sensible. So perhaps, again, could you ask the Minister to look again at that? And the point I was going to make, you've already picked up, clearly that's the policy. It's a sticking plaster. The longer-term solution is to try and provide more supply in these crucially hotspot areas like Edinburgh and Aberdeen, but you've already picked that up. How long would the zone designation last? Is that a matter for Scottish Government, or is that a matter for local authority to recommend in its bid to Government?
What was said in the legislation is that the zone can be for a period of up to 5 years per application. So that's what would that's what would say in terms of how long the zone could be applied for.
If circumstances change, I've used the Aberdeen example, oil price reduces, rent levels are going down, could the local authority apply to deregister the zone to Scottish Government?
Well, ministers have the power to vary the cap, and Kirsten, can you answer this specifically?
They could revoke the instrument that designated the zone. Using the same powers, they could revoke the instrument that designated the zone in the first place if it were no longer appropriate.
So if the local authority who are close to these issues say, circumstances have changed, we don't want to have this rent control anymore, we can apply to Scottish Government and you could deregister it effectively. Okay, that's very clear. Could I just quickly move on then to some wider issues? What best practice has the Scottish Government looked at across Europe in terms of rent controls? For example, in the Netherlands, there's an excellent system where that rent can be charged, which is partly linked to property quality measures. And of course, the great advantage there is that you're stimulating and encouraging landlords to improve the quality of the sector, and therefore rent increases are linked to that. So effectively, it's you've got a 2, 3 to 5 star designation for this sector, which I think tenants would understand. If they're getting improvements in the property, they are more encouraged to pay increased rent. What's your view on that, Mr. Stalker?
Okay. We have looked at other international comparisons for this. I mean, specifically on the Netherlands, like many European countries, the rent controls that they have in place kind of stem from after the Second World War. So that's kind of where they kind of started from. So they've been in place for quite some time, and there's been quite an infrastructure put in place to enable them to continue. I think similar as well in Germany. In terms of Holland, you're right in that in the private rented sector, about two-thirds of the sector has rent control. The top half, or the top third, doesn't apply, but it does apply to the lower sort of two-thirds. The system they have is one where, as you say, they do look to assess properties and link that assessment against the rent that can be charged. My understanding is that Dutch government policy is to look to move away eventually from there being the proportion of properties in the rent control and to look to kind of reduce that. But yes, as a system, it is something which that we have looked at. In terms of what we're proposing in this bill, this is something which is more limited and proportionate compared to what they have in Holland, which is national for most but not all of the PRS properties.
And my final question, Convener, because I know time's against us. I've touched on the point earlier about protection for sitting tenants versus protection for prospective tenants, and I think you've covered that. But the other model in other countries is that they challenge unreasonably high rent levels. What thought have you about that as a method of protecting the sector generally? That's tenants and prospective tenants.
And so just to clarify, when you mentioned challenge unreasonably high rents, do you mean initial rents or?
Yeah, well, both. You know, if you see a trend towards a city where market forces are, meaning that there's quite massive increases, I mentioned the Aberdeen example, 40% over a four-year period, what mechanisms would it exist to try and challenge that to make the sector more affordable.
Okay, I mean, you know, again, looking at international comparisons, we know that this is something that they're looking at in Ireland, in the Republic of Ireland. They're considering what they're sort of calling rent certainty. It's something which I think it's still under development in Ireland. So I don't think they've made any sort of clear decision on that. I think that looking at the evidence and the literature on rent, the different options around rent control, again, there's kind of balances to be struck between if you go beyond a cap into something which is more about the total amount of rent that can be charged, then there could be potential unintended consequences. That's what the literature kind of says. I mean, so this is obviously not something which we've covered in this bill, but since you asked the broader question, there are a number of things that the evidence would say that would need to be considered, so that any intention to use an option around rent control or capping has an intended effect and not an unintended effect, which could, for example, reduce investment in housing or have an effect of pushing rents at the bottom up, which could also happen if the market's constrained in a certain way. So quite a lot to kind of consider on that, the evidence suggests us.
Thank you for that, Cathedral. Thank you. I think my other question was covered there, Convener.
That's fine. I mean, just in terms of bringing our session to a close, can you say a little bit about what steps the Scottish Government is considering in order to raise awareness about the provisions of the new legislation to ensure that tenants and landlords are aware of the new framework?
Yes, absolutely. So, subject to the will of Parliament, if the bill is enacted, then we have set aside a budget set out in the financial memorandum, which will help raise awareness. We do that through marketing. I think it's ranged at £250,000 to £550,000.
Thank you.
And there's a number of options. I mean, there's marketing. You know, there's looking at landlord registration, where you know, local authorities hold the database, but we have the addresses. So there's potential option there. Certainly for landlords, you know, there's email addresses through that database. There's social media. There's also looking at the different sort of portals that are out there when folk are looking to rent. So there's quite a range of options. Clearly, it will be important when it's clear what the legislation says that we raise awareness. And that's something which we're very mindful of.
In terms of the implementation of the bill, you will continue to engage extensively with stakeholders?
Absolutely. On that. We've been very open to engaging with stakeholders in a range of fora, and we continue to do that now and right through the process of the bill and beyond that, if it comes to developing the secondary legislation. So more than happy to do that.
Okay. Do members have any final questions? In that case, it only remains for me to thank the Bill team for attending today's meeting and for their extremely helpful and comprehensive evidence this morning. We will, of course, hear from the Minister for Housing and Welfare later in the Stage 1 consideration process. That concludes this evidence session. I will suspend for a few minutes to allow the committee room to be set up for a further roundtable session with stakeholder witnesses regarding the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill. Thank you. Everyone, we now move to agenda item 2, where the committee will take further evidence on the Private Housing Tenancy Scotland Bill. In order to allow for a more free-flowing discussion, the committee has chosen to conduct this session in a round-table format. However, we are keen to ensure that we receive evidence on all aspects of the bill, and therefore the session will be structured around its different sections. Given the limited time available, it's therefore important, something I'd encourage stakeholders to do, which is to seek to speak on those areas of the bill which are most interest and importance to them. Members will ask questions on the various aspects of the bill. I will allow our witnesses to respond should they have any comments, and committee members can then come back in if they wish to add to the discussion. I'm going to ask each of our participants to introduce themselves, starting with my colleague to the left.
David Stewart, I'm the Labour MSP for the Highlands and Islands region.
I'm Beth Reid, I'm from Crisis, which is the charity representing single homeless people.
Alec Johnston, Conservative member from North East Scotland.
Robert Aldridge from Homeless Action Scotland.
Liz Ely, Living Rent Campaign.
Mike McKenzie, MSP, I represent the Highlands and Islands region.
Rosemary Brotchie, I'm here from Shelter Scotland.
James Dornan, MSP for Glasgow Cathcart.
Fraser Sutherland from Citizens of East Scotland.
Adam Ingram, MSP for Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley.
And I'm Gary Paterson, I'm the Vice President of Communities of the National Union of Students in Scotland.
Okay, thank you very much everyone. We'll just get started. I'll kick off and perhaps just ask in general terms whether our stakeholders think that the proposals in the bill achieve the balance or the rebalancing of the relationship between tenants and landlords, which the government's bill team referred to in the previous session. And perhaps you might want to consider whether that balance improves security of tenure for tenants and provides appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. So who wants to kick us off on that? Rosemary.
Thank you, Convener. Certainly, yes, we very much welcome the opportunity to give evidence on this bill today. We've been working with the government and working with stakeholders across the sector for many years now to bring about change to the private sector tenancy regime, particularly because we think it's a big impediment. The current regime is a big impediment to growth and to the confidence and security and stability that tenants have in the sector. So the changes that we see bringing forward in this bill in principle and in the broad structure are very welcome. They're going to meet the needs of our clients. We do have some concerns which hopefully will come out today about some of the operation and the detail of the terms of the bill. But in broad terms, yes, we're very much in support.
Thank you. We'll come on to the detail, I'm sure, in due course. Robert, did you want to come in?
Just very briefly, Convener, we share that view that it is a great improvement on the short assured tenancy regime. Actually, the assured tenancy in some respects gave greater security of tenure to some tenants, but it's been so little used in recent years that actually what is needed is this modernised tenancy, which will give far more security to most tenants. So, yes, we are in favour of the generality, but we also have some concerns about a number of the details and that's around the edges. But really, it's...
Well, no.
Yeah, okay, I won't.
Who else wants to come in on the generality? Liz.
Yeah, I guess we would sort of echo some of those comments. We do feel that these, you know, the things that are outlined are an improvement, but we do also have some serious concerns about some of the grounds for eviction and particularly the mandatory nature of those grounds. But I think we'll probably come to those, but we do acknowledge that this is a step forward, but there are definitely concerns within that.
Okay, thank you, Beth.
That we know that from research we've done with Shelter, actually, we know that security of tenure is a huge concern, especially for the client groups that we represent, who are often when they go into the private rented sector, they're often in some of the poorer quality tenancies and are really very worried about the security of tenure. So really strongly welcome the removal of no-fault eviction in particular and indefinite tenancies, and also the greater clarity and simplification of the system that it will bring as well. And having a standardised tenancy, I think, will be really helpful in that respect, especially for those who are less able to, perhaps to advocate for themselves or understand complex legal terms as can be in some tenancies now.
Okay, thank you. Gary?
First of all, thanks for giving us the opportunity to come here today. Again, we also welcome a lot of the proposals that are put in place, and we'll get into a little bit more of the detail from our position, but we're quite keen to echo the comments here and to maintain the same kind of level of tenancy so there's not discrepancies between students and the general rent in public. We also very strongly welcome introduction of rent controls as well because of the extent of rent increases, which can really impact students because they're more likely to move around with shorter tenancies.
Okay, super, thank you. Fraser.
Most the same as what everyone's already said, very much welcome the changes and the improvements being made on the current tenancies that are there, especially welcoming the removal of the no-fault ground, which we think is a huge barrier to current tenants and protecting their security of tenure.
Okay, thank you. We're actually going to... I was going to ask...
Yeah, it's okay.
Thank you, David, for your understanding. As always, Michael, you're going to introduce the next section on no-fault ground for repossession and also the private residential tenancy.
Led us nicely into that area because that's one of the significant proposals of the bill to remove the no-fault ground for repossession, and I just wondered how people, what folk felt about that. But also the point's been made that it may, from the landlord's perspective, seek to discourage investment in the sector, and there's been a suggestion made that that may actually impact adversely on tenants by reducing the overall investment and therefore number of houses available in the private rented sector. So I just wondered what your comments were on that theme.
Liz and then Rosemary.
Thanks for that. We're very pleased that the no-fault ground for eviction is going. I think that's going to be really good, or is proposed to be going. That's going to be really good for tenants. With regard to your question about investment, I would make two points. One of them is that countries with a more stringent regulatory sort of framework tend to have larger investment in the private rented sector. So when you look internationally, countries with more stringent rent controls and more regulation do tend to have more investment. So so there's that. But I would also question when we're talking about investment, I think there's a wider question that's possibly out with the scope of this bill about what kind of investment in housing in general we want in Scotland. Scottish Government's own research found that only 8% of people want to live in the private rented sector. So 92% of people do not want to live in the private rented sector. They want to live in their own home that they own or in the social rented sector. So there's also, I think, a wider question about what sort of investment in housing in Scotland that we want and the private rented sector more generally, but also taking into consideration the fact that in countries where there are more, things like the no-fault grounds being removed and more stringent rent controls, there is investment there in the PRS too.
Okay, Rosemary.
Thank you, Convener. I think we need to be clear what we're talking about when we refer to this no-fault ground. It's become a bit of a shorthand, really. What it actually refers to is that when the contract, in the initial period of the tenancy is over, the landlord has the absolute right to end a tenancy after that point by just giving a minimal amount of notice without reference to anything else. And I think the importance of that, obviously, from a landlord's point of view, is to enable them to have that flexibility and the confidence that they can reclaim that tenancy back. That confidence is important to landlords because using the court system, which is their other recourse, has proved difficult for them. And so I think in the introduction of this new tenancy regime, from a landlord's perspective, and I'm sure you'll hear from them directly about this, the use of a tribunal system to replace the courts, the new grounds, the simplification of the process should give them that confidence. And really, professional, reputable landlords who are actively managing their businesses shouldn't have anything to fear from this new tenancy. From a tenant's perspective, removing what we call this no-fault ground actually is hugely significant because what we see... tenants coming to us, coming to shelter, and we get 46% of our calls that come to our telephone helpline are from the private rented sector, and only 14% of the sector of households in Scotland live in the private rented sector. So the really significant thing for tenants is that they're going to have the confidence and the security and crucially bargaining power with their landlords. And we've heard already concerns that tenants have when they make a complaint that they're going to be subject then to retaliatory eviction. And we certainly see many cases of tenants who, for example, have complained about a repair issue, then subsequently being served with a notice to quit, which results in them having to leave the tenancy. So if we're concerned in Scotland with having a high quality, professionally run, an improved private rented sector, we need to give tenants that bargaining power, and they need to be able to act as active consumers in the market.
Thank you, Robert.
Thanks very much. I don't disagree with anything. Rosemary and I were fortunate enough to be part of the tenancy reform group, and one of the discussions we had in that group was about what are the kind of reasons that a landlord would have to want to repossess their property. And we went through all of them, and it is if somebody isn't paying their rent, if somebody's behaving in an antisocial manner, etc., etc. And those are covered in the grounds for repossession under the modern tenancy that we're discussing in this bill. There's a further point, which is that what we're looking to do, I think, and I think it's particularly in the interests of landlords, is to slightly change the reasons people use the private rented sector so that more tenants are in the private rented sector for the long term. They can plan ahead without the uncertainty of perhaps being faced with a notice to quit with 2 months' notice. So people with families can make an investment in their community, in their local schools, and actually use the private rented sector long term. So it's of benefit both to landlords and to tenants to have greater security of tenure. I think the other 2 points I wish to make is that if the no-fault ground were to be reintroduced, it is the only ground that would be used for repossession. You might as well rip up all the other ones because it's easy and it doesn't require any management by the private landlord. Which brings me to the final point, which is that there is also an onus on a landlord who is managing a business to manage it. And so that if somebody is behaving in an antisocial manner, for example, they need to be able to establish that that is what is happening and to manage that property well.
Fraser?
Yeah, really, really, really welcome the removal of the no-fault ground, just mainly for the issues that Rosemary set out. But we've seen a huge move in the types of people who are living in the private rented sector. It's not just where we see students and young professionals that we maybe did 20 or so years ago. We're now seeing a lot more families who want to have a settled life, that want that security, that want to know that they can be certain that they're not just going to be given a very short notice period when they come to the end of their tenancy. And I just wanted to make one point on the question that Mike put about investment. And I think it's about what type of investment we want. I don't think it's really appropriate that people see investing in private rented property as something they just put money in and they make money out of. If you want to invest in the private rented sector, you should be doing it because you want to run the homes for people to live in. It's not, you know, if you just want to make a return on your investment, maybe you should be putting it in a kind of financial product rather than in housing. You've got to have a commitment that you're going to look after that property and look after your tenants if you want to invest it in private housing. And a lot of the good landlords, that's what they do, and that's the kind of people they want to be in the private rented sector. We don't want landlords who just treat it as a way to make a huge profit.
Okay, Gary.
We really strongly support the introduction of this. We know that there's some recommendations from other stakeholders that there should be different categories put in place for students, and we wouldn't really agree with that because we think that basically once you start introducing different categories, it becomes hard to govern how do you determine who's studying what kind of tenancy they would require. And we see that the needs for students are broadly in line with the needs for the rest of tenants as well.
Okay, thank you. Thanks. Beth.
We support everything that's been said so far. You know, the people that we work with, we found that, you know, very often they're very worried about this hanging over. Well, we could be out within 4 weeks' notice, and then where do we go? And I think, like Rosemary was saying, you know, it's about that balance of power between the tenant and the landlord. At the moment, many tenants just want as little contact with the landlord as possible, and then, you know, then they're happy and that's okay. And it's about that rebalancing. And I think the key to making this work is to make sure that the eviction grounds are set out really clearly, that they work straight in a straightforward way, so that both tenants and landlords know exactly what evidence that they need to be able to evidence the ground for eviction. And and that works straightforwardly. We heard in the last evidence session that the majority of cases probably won't go to tribunal, so we need to make sure that it works at the notice to leave stage so that tenants are clear about what would constitute the right grounds of evidence for eviction, and so that landlords do as well. I think if there's any ambiguity about that, it's going to be quite difficult for tenants to enforce their rights.
Okay, Michael.
Thank you, Convener. I was actually quite struck by what Liz had said in terms of there perhaps being lessons for us from other countries, but I wonder if any of our guests agree with me that, and you'll see where I'm coming from representing the Highlands and Islands, that we'll have to treat some of those lessons with a bit of caution, remembering that Scotland's really quite a diverse country. The area I represent contains most of Scotland's islands. We've got rural locations and remote rural locations, in that some caution's required in terms of just transposing something that may seem to work very well in another country and transpose that onto Scotland. But I wondered if any witnesses are aware of any research, or any of your organisations have done research with stakeholders and so on, gathering any kind of evidence that may suggest a scheme that would work well for Scotland, bearing in mind just that precautionary note about the Highlands and Islands.
Who wants to tackle that? Rosemary.
Certainly the evidence from international examples of how tenancy regimes work elsewhere was fully considered by the working group that consulted before this bill was brought forward. And I'm aware that certainly the Scottish Government considered international examples as well, and looked at the sort of security of tenure, I suppose, if that's what we're focusing on at the moment, across Europe and beyond. It's also been the subject of work that Shelter's commissioned some research on, and although I haven't got the work there in front of me, Scotland and the UK as a whole came out very near the bottom of countries for security of tenure. And in fact, the system that we're currently working under, I think, as I said, has led to a lot of the problems that we're seeing existing in the current the current private sector market in Scotland. So regardless of whether you're in an urban or a rural rental market, I think that basic relationship with landlord, between the landlord and the tenant, is absolutely crucial in trying to drive improvement and change. And both enabling, as I said before, tenants to act as more active consumers, but also crucially encouraging landlords to view letting as a business. And we are asking landlords to up their game, and I think the landlords who are involved in consulting and looking in on this bill will be hoping that actually one of the consequences is that some of the less professional, more disreputable, if you like, landlords and letting agents will look at the new market and say, actually, that's not somewhere we want to be, which will leave space for the more reputable and responsible landlords to grow their businesses.
Liz.
Yeah, I mean, I guess sort of in bringing up international examples in that particular instance, it was as much to sort of allay fears around investment. I think one of the things that we hear time and time again is that any extra regulation is going to scare away investment. And if you do anything, then that means there won't be investment, and then that will take away supply. And I guess, looking to other countries where there is larger scale investment, there is also stricter regulatory frameworks in those countries as well. So even though it's not, we might not want to necessarily take a model from another country right now and slap it bang on to Scotland. Certainly when we're looking at this issue about investment and supply, we can see that, investment isn't struggling in other countries where there's a stricter regulatory framework.
Do any of the witnesses have anything specific, before I bring in members, do witnesses have anything specific to say on good practice from other locations, particularly internationally? If not, I'll invite members to come in. I've got Adam, David, and then Alec.
Yeah, Liz highlighted the point. I think you said that nobody actually wants to be in the private rented sector. Now, that's not a universal phenomenon across Europe, quite frankly. Lots of countries, they have a very strong private rented sector. Now, is that as a consequence of the poor security of tenure historically that we've had in the private rented sector? And could this bill not presage a significant investment as demand might rise for homes in the private rented sector? Is this, if we're addressing the security of tenure issue, which I think Robert had indicated was one of the constraints on people actually coming forward and seeking a private rented accommodation, is that where we should, is that an important departure from?
I think it is. A large number of people have regarded the private rented sector as somewhere before they buy a house or somewhere, a kind of transient stage. I think it's a real possibility when this whole system gets bedded in that people will begin to regard the private rented sector as a housing option for the long term, which can be valued. And with, so long as it's combined with good quality housing management by good quality private landlords, I think it will begin to be seen as a longer term housing option for a broader range of people. So yes, I think that could happen.
Gary?
I think I certainly agree with that point. And looking at the kind of situation for students in particular, it's really difficult for us to not be in the private rented sector. I can't really buy a house at this stage of my life. But for us to imagine ourselves in a long-term property when every 6 months or every 12 months we have to apply again and not really know what the landlord's plans are for the property that you're staying in, and also you're kind of putting yourself in a position where you have to negotiate financially with the landlord in some scenarios. So I think evening out the balance and giving people more ownership over the places that they call homes is really important.
Okay. Liz, briefly.
Yeah, I would just echo that the removal of the no fault could have that consequence. But I and that actually, you know, the fact that only 8% of people want to live in the private rented sector is in part due to the lack of security. But it's also the least affordable tenure type as well. It's much more affordable. I'm 10 years away from being a student, even though I might not look it, and I still can't afford to buy a house. But people that I know with mortgages pay less on their mortgage than I do to rent a one bed flat. And we know the social rented sector is a lot more affordable as well. So I think affordability has to come in with security for it to be a desirable tenure type for people.
Thank you. David?
Yeah, I think Adam's actually covered the point. I was just going to make a sort of philosophical point that I'll make a very brief philosophical point. If you take examples from, I think, France and Italy, the ability to rent there is seen as quite normal. The aspiration to buy isn't the same as it is as here. So I just want to echo Adam's point, and it's hard to change that philosophy, but maybe we need to look, why is it more acceptable in Italy? Is it about tenure? Is it about rent control? But certainly my experience of friends over there who are teachers, they think it's quite standard to rent, but they tend to find it's a longer-term lease. So they might have a five-year lease with rent controls. Maybe that's something we need to bear in mind in this debate.
Okay. Thank you, David. Ali, do you have a different philosophical point?
The moment has passed, I think. The moment has passed.
The moment has passed.
I'll look for the opportunity to come back.
There'll be other moments, don't worry.
Can I just add one small point to this discussion, which is that we've been conducting a campaign over the last 18 months or so, and we've got a huge amount of support from people across Scotland. And some of that support has actually come from landlords as well, who have looked at what the current situation is and looked at how they're able to attract people to the sector. And landlords want people to stay long-term. It's of no benefit to them to be moving tenants through quickly through the sector. So actually being able to make an offer and say, you know, we would like to let you and keep you here should be of a real benefit to landlords and should attract the right kinds of landlords, as well as appeal to the growing number of people in the sector who are families with children, for example, which now make up over a quarter of people in the private rented sector.
Thank you. James, did you want to introduce our section on the initial tenancy period?
I did. Clearly, I'd be interested to hear the witnesses' views on the initial tenancy period of 6 months, particularly to hear if they agree that the tenant should be restricted from ending their tenancy during this period unless the landlord agrees. And then also particularly keen to hear from Robert from Homeless Action and Gary from NUS, who didn't comment on this in their contributions.
Robert.
Okay. My own view and Homeless Action Scotland's view was that when you have a position of an indefinite tenancy, which is on a month-to-month basis, that the need for an initial tenancy period isn't really there. The need for an initial tenancy period was really linked to the short assured tenancy to say, well, it's not going to be less than 6 months. You're going to have at least 6 months before a landlord can give you notice. But given that there are notice periods built in to this new tenancy, we personally, as an organisation, didn't see the need for any initial tenancy period other than, you know, that you have to have a tenancy period, which is, say, a month, because it's going to last indefinitely unless either side seeks to end it, either with the appropriate notice periods or by establishing grounds for eviction. And you could have amended the grounds, you know, such as landlord wishes to sell, to say that could not be invoked in the first 6 months or a year of a tenancy. So in our view, we felt that an initial tenancy period was not necessary, but it's not something, you know, we're going to die in a ditch for, because it's not an impediment to the legislation.
I don't want to give a reborn response, but I'd like to echo Robert's point on that. We didn't note anything there. I have to say, I don't want to make NUS policy on the hoof, but anything that we haven't noted in there, we would go back and consult with our membership over the rest of the cycle of the legislation. But I agree that you know, having the flexibility and the kind of long-term ownership over the property is something that we really support as an organisation.
Anyone else? Liz?
Yeah, I mean, we really don't think that there needs to be this six-month initial period, and we feel quite strongly that tenants shouldn't be tied in to a six-month initial period for a number of reasons. In a lot of places, there's a lot of demand for tenancies, and a landlord might pressure a tenant to stay longer where and be tied in longer than they actually want to be in, and tenants do need that flexibility. But we also feel there are some serious equalities issues with tying tenants into six-month periods. We've got a number of affiliates, including trade unions, charities. One of our affiliates is Zero Tolerance, who pointed out that actually, you know, that six-month period, if you're in an abusive relationship and you need to leave an abusive relationship quickly, and you know that you've got 6 months of rent that you have to pay, is, you know, creates a further barrier. Women face a lot of barriers to leaving abusive relationships in the home, and having this six-month, you have to pay your rent, just adds another barrier on top of that, where there are a lot of stresses. And as Robert commented, you know, there's really no need for this initial period to be there, and it does have the potential to create you know, hardship for some groups of tenants. So you know, we don't feel that it's appropriate to have an initial fixed period for tenants.
Okay, anyone else? In that case, James?
Very interesting point about abusive relationships, and I'm sure that they'll be some discussion about how that one is resolved, if it's not already in the suggested bill. But okay, I'd like to go on to the notice of the end of tenancy and ask if you agree with the Scottish Government that the bill's proposal regarding notices to end of tenancy are simplified, and the proposed timescales strike a good balance between the interests of landlords and the tenants. Again, I'd like to ask Cass Fraser this time, and Gary, who had some specific views on this proposal.
Yeah, well, we'd raised just the point exactly that Liz had just raised in terms of the tenant-to-landlord notice to leave around people obviously fleeing abusive relationships, and anything that puts people off having to pay an extended period of rent would maybe stop them from leaving that situation would really not be in the interests of anyone. And just to raise a specific point around that, currently the housing benefit rules allow for claimants to get 4 weeks on two different properties if they have to leave a property for that reason. So if we're then intending that people have to give 8 weeks, then that's leaving them with 4 weeks of money that they have to find themselves if they're on housing benefit. So they're essentially paying for 4 weeks for having to leave for that situation. So that's not really ideal. Now, I don't know if there's some way that can be changed so that people, you know, tenants have the ability to leave where they feel in a threatened relationship. So the situation that we would prefer, essentially, around notice leave from tenants to landlords is just to have the one fixed 4 week notice period that's proposed for the first period. I think that would be much easier as well for tenants to understand, because it would then be no matter what point that you are leaving at, it's the one 4 week standard timescale.
Our feeling on this is that 4 weeks is actually not a lot of time. You know, it's basically just a month. If you think if that could happen midway through the year, could be happening around about this time of the year where you're being told in 4 weeks' time you need to be out. I'm sitting thinking about all my assignments and maybe part-time work I've got to do as well. So as well, looking at areas like Aberdeen, Glasgow and Edinburgh where housing is quite difficult to come by, it can take a lot longer sometimes than 4 weeks. We see students having to come into the city before they start at their university or college and sometimes staying with friends or in hotels for even more than 4 weeks. So we think that a period closer to 8 weeks would actually be more suitable.
Okay. Fine. Adam, you're going to introduce the next section on termination of the tenancy by the landlord.
Yes, grounds for eviction. Do you think the eviction grounds that have been included in the bill are reasonable from a tenant's point of view, and will they work effectively in practice? And are there any in particular that would cause a problem for tenants?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the general grounds are the right grounds, but I think there are some problems in wording. I mean, things like the landlord intends is used, I think, right the way through, and I think that needs to be firmed up a lot more. Our own view as an organisation is that it would be more appropriate if all the grounds were discretionary rather than mandatory. We have a new tribunal system coming in, which is the whole aim of that is to look at the broader interests of a case and to come to kind of common sense agreement. I think that if you have mandatory grounds, there's a danger that in anomalous cases, all the boxes will be ticked when in fact it is unreasonable for an eviction to happen. And I think in particular that there are areas like the landlord intends to sell. I mean, it would be perfectly possible for a landlord to put property on the market at a highly inflated price that they were absolutely sure they were not going to get, showing an intention to sell an advert, whatever it is, the tenant be evicted and somebody else move in. And then the penalty is simply 3 months' rent, which seems to me to be a very paltry penalty. Similarly, it may be that the landlord states that they intend for a member of their family to move in permanently. But, you know, how the thing is that the eviction will happen before the moving in happens. So what happens if it doesn't? Is it simply a penalty of 3 months' rent, which is, again, a very, very small amount, which is not really a deterrent whatsoever. So in our view, in a whole range of these cases, it would be more appropriate for the tribunal to investigate how reasonable in the circumstances it is for the eviction to be granted. And I'm sure, you know, I know some landlords will be quite concerned about that, but in 95-98% of the cases, it will be straightforward and they will be able to regain possession. But where there is this element of doubt, I think it is quite important. And I think that there are other things as well. You know, it does seem to us that if the landlord intends to sell, there isn't any reason why the tenant should have to move out until the contract of sale is concluded, because nobody else is going to move in. Similarly, with kind of the refurbishment ground, it depends how big the refurbishment is. Is there going to be a discussion with the tenant as to whether they're prepared to put up with 3 weeks' disruption and stay as the tenant, or simply be evicted under the mandatory eviction? So I think there's a whole lot of grey areas which aren't well served by the grounds being mandatory.
Okay, thank you. Beth?
As I said earlier, you know, the grounds for eviction are the key to making this system work well or not. So we need to make sure that the grounds are set out are really clear and don't provide loopholes. I think in terms of the grounds that they're currently, we would broadly agree with all of them. But I think it does come down to how they're evidenced, as Robert was saying. You know, what would a tenant need to know to show that the landlord is genuinely going to sell? And as I said before, that's that you, in most cases, will be about the notice to leave and not going to the tribunal, because most cases won't go to the tribunal, so we need to make sure it's at that stage. I think there are some of the grounds that could be worded more clearly. The abandonment one, for example, currently says you have to not be living there as your main home. Well, if you're meeting all of the elements of the tenancy agreement, you're paying your rent and so on, does it matter if you're not there for a part of the year or whatever? So I think we need a lot more clarity in that ground. I think the one about the rent arrears grounds, at the moment, as I understand it, you would need all three of those grounds for it to be mandatory. But again, I'm not entirely sure that's clear. And the other one that's new in there is cessation of the landlord's registration. Now, if that's about being struck off the local authority list, that's one thing. If that's about the landlord ceasing to be registered and therefore saying that the tenant has to be evicted on that basis, then that I don't think that would be acceptable from our point of view, so that needs some clarity. So it's about making sure those grounds work really well and really clearly, both for the tribunal but at an earlier stage before that as well.
Thank you. Gary and then Rosemary.
Just to echo what Robert said as well about the penalty that would be in place for landlords, the penalty for the tenant would be much more significant if they're having to be made to leave their property. So we recognise the points that are raised in terms of the grounds that are noted. We think that the tribunals that are being set up provide an opportunity to work on those issues without any need for mandatory grounds in place. But we would, if they're to go forward, we'd like to at least see discretionary elements attached to them. For example, the term grounds for refurbishment could, it isn't really detailed what that means. It could mean a lick of paint at this point. The tenants has otherwise breached the tenancy agreement. Again, could be for a very minor situation. We even talked earlier on today about debt and that being spread over a couple of months. Technically, that is breaching the agreement. If I could just speak briefly as well about some of the recommendations from some stakeholders about student tenancies being implemented. I think as a student, I'd be really concerned about those proposals. My feeling is that it's not in students' interest to not say that they're going to be leaving, because we don't want to get lumbered with loads of debt and rent that we can't afford to pay. We think that better communication with landlords to the tenants to understand what they'll be wanting to do in the next couple of months could alleviate some of the issues. But just generally, the highlighting of the student cycle, if you will, or the student market, it currently doesn't meet the needs for students, so we wouldn't regard what currently exists as best practice. And we wouldn't want that to continue into these new proposals.
Yeah, thank you. Rosemary and then Liz.
Thank you, Convener. Generally speaking, we think, as we've discussed already, that the range of reasons that are set out for landlords wanting to be able to recover possession under these grounds are the right ones, and they cover the range of reasons that landlords might need to use. However, I agree with colleagues around the table that the detail of how they operate in practice needs some scrutiny. I'll just try and draw attention to ones that haven't already been mentioned, although I echo what Robert said around how the landlord's intention is defined in relation to attention to sell, for example, and also to refurbish needs to be tightened. It should be much more than just an aspiration. We should see evidence there that actively marketing the property is taking place. The ground which relates to breach of tenancy agreement currently refers to materially failing a statutory term. And I think we need to understand what that actually means in terms of materially failing, to ensure that tenants can't be evicted just simply for breaching a term of a tenancy that might be statutory but shouldn't really reasonably give rise to an eviction. I think the one particularly I'd like to draw attention to, however, and it's come up a number of times already, is around the rent arrears ground. I think that as was referred to in the earlier session by Mr. Stewart, that this actually is disproportionate in terms of the outcomes it could result for in tenants, and for a number of reasons. We heard the case study earlier on of a tenant who may have been entering a job and being paid a salary 1 month late. But there are also, although under this ground and in the schedule, it's specified that delays or errors in benefit payment might be excluded or taken into account, universal credit is designed in its very nature to be paid 4 weeks in arrears. And on top of that 4 weeks, 7 days delay is built in before you can even apply. So that doesn't fall within that exclusion around an error or a delay in benefit payment. And that is just how the system is designed to work. And so I think the proposal to evict a tenant after 3 months, if they have 1 month's arrears at any point within that 3 months, is disproportionate and needs to be looked at again. We think that there should be an increase to at least 3 months' rent arrears over that period, which is actually in line with the current ground for possession under rent arrears. Just finally, I think there needs to be a little bit further scrutiny around the ground for eviction where a landlord has ceased to be registered with a local authority, and I think there needs to be alternatives looked at for that, because a tenant under those circumstances would be suffering the loss of their home on the basis of a landlord's failure, and I think we need to look carefully at whether or not that's a reasonable cause for eviction.
Okay, Liz, and then I think Beth, you wanted to come back in.
Yeah, I guess Rosemary's covered quite a few of the additional things I was going to say, just to sort of echo very strongly, you know, that we do strongly agree about the fact about it being mandatory. I think landlords and tenants agree that life requires discretion, and I think, you know, these grounds, you know, need to be discretionary because of you know, the many varied circumstances, you know, that do come up. And yeah, that actually penalising tenants for the behaviour of landlords and, you know, leading to a tenant losing their home isn't the right way to deal with bad practice in the sector. I would just the final thing to add in terms of discretion is that we would like to see something like a hardship clause being built into this when something's taken to a tribunal. So, you know, with the case of rent arrears or antisocial behaviour, it might be that a tenant, you know, needs time to sort out a particular issue, and we feel that there should be some sort of thing built in whereby a court could postpone or delay a decision to repossess a property that might give a tenant time to get financial advice or to resolve an antisocial behaviour sort of situation, because obviously losing your home, you know, is a catastrophic event, you know, bringing a lot of hardship, and, you know, some discretion within that, I think, is required.
Rosemary, was it specifically on this?
Yep. And I think I'd like to echo what Liz has said, and it's come up earlier, that this is why we need the first tier tribunal being given discretion to adjourn proceedings, so they have that opportunity to consider more complex cases.
Hey, Beth?
On the point about penalties and the maximum award of 3 months' rent to the tenant where there's been a wrongful eviction. And I mean, I think, you know, if there's been a wrongful eviction, and particularly in cases where a landlord has deliberately misled a tribunal, 3 months award, 3 months rent award to the tenant seems very insignificant, given that they've misled, you know, a tribunal. And I think it's also worth considering the other costs. If somebody is wrongfully evicted from their property and then they go to the local authority to make a statutory homelessness application, there's considerable costs involved there for the local authority. So again, I think 3 months, 3 months rent to the, it's not a huge deterrent from actually doing those things, and we need to make sure that the tribunal system has teeth and acts as a deterrent from bad landlords doing things wrongly.
Thank you. We'll need to move on from this section, but I'll give the final word to Citizens Advice Scotland.
So just to add, build on what Beth was saying there about the wrongful termination orders and getting the 3 months back, but I think it would be really keen for us to look at a way in which if someone has misled a tribunal, are they still then a fit and proper person as the test is required for landlord registration? And I think the answer would be no if they have deliberately misled a tribunal, especially on more than one occasion. And I would expect a local authority to be allowed to look at that as the fit and proper person test and therefore remove their registration status in order that they could be a landlord.
Okay, thank you. Alex, you're going to introduce our next section on recourse to the first tier tribunal for wrongful termination.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener.
Rent increases.
I'm very interested to hear people's views on the Bill's provisions in this area. But particularly in practice, do you think that it's likely that tenants will make proper use of these provisions? And also, I'd be interested in other people's comments on the suggestion by Homeless Action Scotland that other third parties should be able to bring cases to the tribunal on behalf of a tenant.
Who wants to take that up? Robert.
Not another, but I am Homeless Action Scotland. I suppose just to build on that, the idea of third parties being able to take up cases, I think we're all aware of particular landlords who have a very bad reputation, a small number of bad landlords who may actually intimidate tenants, for example. We're also aware of particular areas in Scotland where there have been activities by private landlords which are bordering on the extremely criminal. And I think it is important in those circumstances that if a local authority, for example, wishes to take action, that it is able to do so if there is, say, a pattern by a landlord over a number of properties of manipulating the situation, that they can then do so without it being all of the onus being on a tenant to take action. Of course, tenants must be entitled to do that, but most tenants who have been through this will be more focused on finding another home and moving on than going through the process of taking the landlord to the tribunal for a wrongful termination order, where the most they might get is 3 months' rent. So I think it's quite important that, particularly where there's a pattern, for example, that a local authority or another could take that forward.
Liz.
We support the idea, I would say, to have a third party be able to do that and take things to tribunal for the reasons outlined by Robert. If you've lost your home or about to lose your home, it's a very stressful time. There's a lot of hardship involved. Going going to court and going to tribunal is probably something that's out with your experience. You're not sure how to go about it, and you've got a lot of other things on your plate, possibly with family, if you've got a family and things like that. So actually the ability of a third party to take cases to tribunal would allow these penalties to actually be implemented, because I think that's part of it as well. In one aspect, there's the threat of the penalty, but on the other hand, if these penalties are never given out and nobody's ever charged any money, then it's kind of an empty threat. So we need these penalties to be used where bad practice is evident and it needs to have teeth. And those teeth need to bite sometimes. And in order for that to happen, people need to take those to tribunal. And a lot of tenants, I think, just won't be able to do that for their own sort of life sort of circumstances. So I think it's actually quite important that third parties are able to do that.
Okay, thank you for that. Who's next? Rosemary and then Gary.
Thank you. I think we've heard already the importance of access to justice for both landlords and tenants in ensuring both how well this new tenancy is received and used and how effective it is in practice. And we've already heard from the government again that the implementation timetable for the new tenancy will fall in line with the implementation of the new tribunal system. So I think understanding the relationship between the two is absolutely crucial. And I think we would like to see from the government more certainty around what sort of advice and assistance and legal representation is going to be available to vulnerable or low-income tenants to make sure that they can access justice.
Okay, Gary.
Yeah, I'd echo that comment as well. Just coming from a student's perspective, I think the idea of going to a tribunal could be quite daunting, particularly for someone who's maybe just moved away from home. They're living in a new town. They don't really know that many people, and they feel perhaps that there's not an equal relationship between themselves and the landlord, and that the balance of power is tipped against them. So any support that could be provided in that regard, I think, would be very useful, because otherwise I don't expect students would necessarily feel comfortable going out and using the tribunal system.
Beth.
Just to echo everything that's been said already, and I think the other thing to factor into that would be the level of fees in terms of accessing the tribunal and making sure that's accessible that way as well.
Okay. Fraser.
To say on what Robert was saying about the third-party referrals, I think it's really important. There's a pattern, again, what Robert was saying, of a kind of abuse by a landlord. I mean, already the local authorities have the ability to make third-party referrals to the PRHP under the Housing Scotland Act, which is just about to come in force for them to be able to do that. So it kind of builds already on the powers that they already do, and they're already doing this. So it's kind of just another string to their bow, that another reason that they could take it.
Alex.
notice that in the written submissions and during the discussion around the table, but both Homeless Action Scotland and Crisis, who I'm sitting between, have expressed the view that the penalties available for wrongful termination are too weak. So do you have any alternative approach that you would suggest?
Beth.
Fraser mentioned landlord registration and how that's linked to particularly where there's been the landlord has misled the tribunal, so I think that would be certainly something to explore. I mean, I think there are models elsewhere where penalties are much more significant. I think it is a different system, but in Ireland there are, in some cases, there are penalties of up to €20,000 for certain breaches. Now, like I say, it is a different system to this, but 3 months rent in an average two-bed property would be about £1,800 of money, and for the costs of, you know, removing and, you know, having to pay another deposit when you haven't necessarily got your current deposit back, and all of those costs that are associated with moving, not setting aside all the emotion costs as well, that it's not a huge amount of money in some cases for that. And as I mentioned earlier also, you know, the costs to the local authority if there's been a homelessness application, again, could mount to well beyond that. And, you know, you could even consider looking at whether in such a situation like that, the landlord should be contributing some of the costs to the local authority.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are a range of things that can be used. Our submission was suggesting that if a landlord is deliberately misleading and deliberately being disingenuous, that it should be a criminal offence and subject to quite severe penalties, including potential imprisonment. Now, I'm not a legal expert, but I have been told that there is a common law offence of fraud and uttering, which might be able to be used. I think there's also potential of using kind of contempt of court proceedings, if that's possible, in relation to tribunals, and so on. But I think that the deterrent value of deliberately misleading a tribunal or deliberately misusing these grounds should be not simply that the tenant gets adequate compensation, but that there's also a punitive element against the landlord that amounts to a real deterrent.
Okay, Alex.
Anyone
else?
The next item on the list I have in front of me is rent increases, and without going into too much detail on the question, could you please have your comments on the proposals regarding rent increases?
Who wants to go first? Rosemary.
I think that as the government set out earlier, that the mechanism has to be there for landlords to increase rent during a tenancy, but also for there to be a limit to that so that it's not used as a way of sort of getting a tenant out through the back door, if you like, under the new secure arrangements. So I think what's been proposed strikes a good balance. It enables tenants to have that certainty about rent rises within their own tenancy, and yet allow the market to operate outside of that. That proposal for the operation of rent increases alongside the suggestions of a rent penalty zone, I think, again, strike a good balance.
Liz.
Yeah, I guess, you know, our experience as tenants and, you know, through all the tenants that we've consulted with is that actually there is a crisis of affordability in the private rented sector now. It is the most expensive tenure type, and in particular areas, we understand there are areas where it's not as expensive. But given that, you know, market rates are too expensive for a lot of people, we have reports of people actually, you know, tenants doing illegal things and overcrowding flats themselves is very common just so that they can afford to live in places like Edinburgh and Aberdeen. So this is a key issue when it comes to security as well, because we've had people feedback to us that, you know, yes, I feel secure in my property. I would feel secure with the no-fault ground removed, but if the rent went up, then I wouldn't feel secure. So in terms of what's being proposed in this actual in this actual bill. We feel that rents should be regulated for new tenants, not just sitting tenants, because most rent increases at the moment do happen between tenancies. So regulating rents just for sitting tenants won't actually bring down that kind of overheated market element in rent pressure areas, because people will still be able to increase rates between tenancies, and in particular areas like Edinburgh and Aberdeen, where you've got a lot of students and people do move around quite a bit, it won't actually do enough to bring down that kind of rent pressure. And actually, the measure that's being used, CPI plus 1% plus N, which when N has to be a positive number, in the past CPI has been as much as 8.5%, even though it's low at the moment. The formula that's actually being used could lead to sort of quite high increases. I mean, we do welcome, the fact that these are being proposed, but we do think that more work needs to be done in future for to address the kind of quality issues there.
Okay, Robert and then Beth.
Just very briefly, we're quite happy with the proposals in the bill as they are at the moment as an interim measure, because we do understand that there's particular issues that need to be dealt with, particularly around the Aberdeen area at the moment, and it is a means of doing that. I think the bill team's evidence was very wise on this, in that it's a very complex area indeed, and we think that what we would recommend is that we spend a considerable amount of time investing in looking at a sustainable long-term system for the future. All kinds of systems have unintended consequences, and I think we really need to get this right, and it's far more complex than we could simply put on the face of this bill.
On rent pressure zones, just briefly, Barry mentioned in the last session the importance of the wider measures around it, and I think the rent pressure zones is very much a temporary solution, and if you don't get those wider measures right, then you're going to be in a situation where you're just going to have to keep the rent pressure zone and renew it every 5 years to stop, if you've got a massive increase in rents in the wider sector, then sitting tenants will just have to meet those when the rent pressure zone ends. There is a point in there about charges for improvements, which presumably means increases in rents to reflect improvements, and I think that needs to be clarified, both in terms of it being an increase in rent, but also in terms of how that would work in practice and what kind of improvements a landlord might be able to put into the rent. Just on the rent increases more specifically, so the one rise in 12 months with 12 weeks notice, that's very welcome. And it's really important to be able to challenge those any rent rises which seem to be higher than would be expected through the rent officer and also through the tribunal. And again, that's about making that process accessible, so making sure that any fees are realistic and that the length of time to challenge, I think, is 21 days in there at the moment. So that seems to be quite a short and fairly, quite a very short time, especially people need to get advice and so on. And also there is a point in there about the liability for rent. If people have a big rent increase and it takes a long time for the tribunal to come to a decision, then some people could be liable for a very big rent increase at the end of that, which they would have to pay off in full in 28 days. And that could lead them into the grounds for eviction under rent arrears if that's not looked at. So there should be discretion, I think, for rent officers and for the tribunal to allow that to be longer than 28 days to pay that money back.
Those are both very helpful points. David, did you want to come in briefly?
Convener. And I was just keen to get a bit more debate about the rent pressure zones. The witnesses would have... Yes, okay.
Let's finish off this section.
Okay,
first.
Thank you, Convener.
Gary, you wanted to make a point on rent increases.
One of our main concerns in particular is for prospective tenants, and there's a worry that basically landlords can just be playing catch-up, so they've had someone in for a certain period of time, and then, as was noted earlier on, they could have a number of different properties at different levels. In cities like Aberdeen, where rents for students have increased over 40-50%, but the level of income hasn't increased for them, we think that there's a disconnect there, but there's us ways of looking at that. We obviously think that building more affordable social housing is one way of looking at things, but in terms of understanding the problems in the area, looking at the applications that are coming in for local housing support and opportunities would be one way of noting if there's income issues within a hot zone.
Okay, thank you. Fraser?
I have nothing. Beth just covered the point that I was going to make about the notice periods and getting help and support, so I won't repeat exactly the same thing again.
Okay, thank you very much. David, can you move us on to the issue of rent pressures on this, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'm on the right point there. I'm kind of happy to raise this. Witnesses would have heard our previous debate about this area, and you know, my general view is it seems quite a sensible designation. Just to remind witnesses, the procedure would be it has to come from local authorities, it then goes to Scottish Government under the affirmative procedure, and then it's designated. There's no minimum size, there's no maximum size, obviously up to the boundary of the local authority. So some issues around there, it would only affect existing tenants, but if I give you an example, an area is declared a rent pressure zone, someone moves in to a house within that zone, are they then subject to it, or is it after 12 months, or is it after the current tenancy comes to an end? So there's issues around that we need to debate. So I'm just keen to get some views around that. And I think Liz raised a technical issue around CPI. Obviously, we have to have some measure of inflation, and as you'll know, CPI is actually a lower index than retail price, which is normally about 3.75% higher. But I think there's all these issues we need to get some information about. So just want to throw open, convener, and get some views.
Thank you, David. Rosemary.
I think the value in the rent pressure zone isn't just the impact that it can have on tenants, sitting tenants' rent increases during the period it's in operation. I think the real value in designating a rent pressure zone is the power and the focus it would give for local authorities to actually examine and act on the rental market problems that they have in their area. And I think local authorities as strategic bodies already have to produce local housing strategies. I think a local authority that's considering a rent pressure zone will have to, as part of the legislation, consult within the local authority area on the designation. But they should also be an onus on them to consider the impact that this should have on their local housing strategy and what other kinds of measures should be taking place. So, for example, it should be a red alert that more affordable housing is needed in that area, and there should be steps taken to ensure that affordable housing is provided. But I also wanted to reinforce a point that Robert made in relation to the previous question, which is that the infrastructure, if you like, around controlling rents in other countries has been there for many, many years. And I think this is such a complex area that what we would want to see as a result of the focus that's been brought on this issue through the passage of this bill is the government to go away and take some time as a result of this bill to fully consider impact of rent across Scotland, to understand affordability, and to think about what additional measures or mechanisms might be put in place in future to deal with this issue.
A very good, Rosemary made some number of very interesting points. But is there a worry, and I think landlords have expressed this, that there could be an escape of capital? So, for example, the north of Aberdeen is designated, the south isn't. Is that potential new investment would go to the area that's not covered by the rent pressure zone because you can increase rents more there than you can in the rent pressure zone? What's your thoughts?
Under the current arrangements and the current proposals, the rent pressure zone would only affect sitting tenants. So new investment coming in and letting properties for the first time would be able to set a market rent effectively. So I don't think it would have that impact. But I think part of the responsibility of the local authority when they're considering a rent pressure zone is then to think about what impact that would have on the market as a whole and to think about what measures they might take to introduce and encourage new investment into private renting to improve supply. That should be one of the things they take into account.
Liz?
I would just sort of reiterate sort of the importance within a rent pressure zone, I think, of this applying to prospective as well as sitting tenants in any property, because you can see how, like, you know, if there was a rent pressure zone designated and a landlord knew that it was a rent pressure zone and they knew that once a tenant was in the property, they wouldn't be able to increase a rent by whatever they want, that would create an additional impetus to set a very high high rent for a new tenant or to overcompensate for the fact that they're in a rent pressure zone, so I can't put it up too much while they're in there. But before they're in, you know, I better, you know, put the rent up quite a bit. So, and we think that actually if it applied to prospective as well as sitting tenants, you know, that problem wouldn't be there.
Surely that would then mean that the investor wouldn't invest
in that particular area, but it might increase supply and also, I mean, we you know, what are we wanting to invest in? Maybe that's a red flag for the local authority to invest in more affordable housing in that area if the rent pressure is that high in that area.
I think the point has been made, though, that you have. Introducing rent controls is a complicated business, so there's, I think the evidence we've heard suggests all of that. I mean, you can get into situations where ceilings become floors, that actually you bid up the rent levels in an area by introducing controls. So I would like to see an awful lot more research done in this particular area, and I think that's the consensus from I'm getting from the groups here.
Clearly, there have been similar measures introduced in other countries, but perhaps it would be good for us to learn what the experience has been from these other locations. Do witnesses feel that the provisions in the bill go far enough? Does anyone have a view on that? Liz?
We don't feel that they go far enough, although we do accept and echo the fact that rent controls are complex and more research is needed. And as a starting point, we're pleased with what is being offered. But that actually, you know, for example, you could have a measure which was CPI plus N, where N could be a negative number in extreme cases. Now it usually wouldn't be, but if that was possible, then that would go a little bit further towards. Actually making renting affordable, which it currently isn't.
I've got two, but she's wanted to come in. Yep,
please. Yeah, sorry, just on that point, that's a good point. But of course, CPI itself can be negative if we have deflation, so that incentive would be covered.
And then Rosemary?
Yeah, I mean, we've noted earlier on some of our concerns with some of the detail, but more broadly, I think, first of all, we're really happy that there is some form of rent control being introduced, but it's very much a small step at this stage, and we'd like to see much more significant development in that area. As far as I see it, there's a severe disconnect between the expectations on people in society for the rent that they have to pay in comparison to the income that they have, particularly for students who struggle to find part-time work and have to rely on their student loan and bursary. There's a question to be asked about reasonable investment into properties and then a reasonable expectation of what should come out of that. And my concern about tying it to a kind of capital market price, it doesn't relate in reality to the income and the lives of the people that are living in those properties. Just finally as well, we've talked about it before, but the ability for landlords to basically massively hike up rents after a tenant has left and someone would move in is negative for society in general, I think, but it would definitely impact students because we are much more mobile in the cities that we live in.
Yeah, thank you. Rosemary?
I think, notwithstanding what we've said about the complexity of this, the this whole area, and it was certainly something that was considered in a great deal of detail in the process that led to the bill being published, the two big changes that are coming forward and the two things that tenants, when we speak to them, what they really want is the security of tenure, which is the most fundamental thing that this bill is seeking to achieve. But what they're also getting from this is a certainty about rents during the time of their tenancy, which again is just as important. And I think, you know, with an eye to ensuring that we can create a sector which is going to thrive and grow, and that we can see an increase in supply, because fundamentally high prices are to do with the lack of supply. We would certainly want to see the government take a much longer term look about rents and affordability and to understand what's best done to tackle those. But I think what we currently have in this bill strikes the right balance.
Okay. Thank you. Does that point perhaps bring us back to a point which Liz made at the beginning of our session, which is that there are wider issues around the affordable, where we place investment and how we provide affordable housing for people in Scotland. But, I'm not sure that the bill can tackle that, but that's perhaps a good point to end on. Did you have any further points that you wanted to make, David?
No, convener. I think the points have been covered very comprehensively.
Are there any issues in terms of what's being proposed in the bill that we haven't covered off in our roundtable discussion this morning that witnesses would like to raise? This is your last chance. Certainly in terms of this morning. Robert?
Can I just one which I'm slightly confused about under the standard terms of the tenancy, proposed to be a requirement on tenants to inform the landlord of anyone who's staying with them. It seemed to me that that was quite a large intrusion, and I was wondering whether it would be more appropriate for somebody staying with them as their principal home might actually be a more appropriate way of phrasing.
Thank you for that. That's helpful. Rosemary?
Hasn't come up so far in this morning's evidence is part six of the bill, which refers to the tenant having the right to, a partner of a tenant having the right to succeed to that tenancy upon the tenant's death. This is a very welcome move. We fully support this, and it brings private sector tenancies in line with the situation in the social sector. I'm sure it'll come up in later evidence sessions, and I wanted to get on record that we would fully support this being.
Thank you very much. Any other final points? Nope. Okay, I think we've covered a lot of ground this morning. I'm very grateful to members and also to witnesses for their time and their contributions this morning. Thank you for that. The next meeting is on the 11th of November. The committee will hold a second roundtable discussion on the bill, this time from organisations representing the landlord and letting agent industry, and we will take evidence from the Minister for Housing on a statutory instrument on the private rented housing panel. That concludes today's committee business. I close this meeting of the committee.